morning, everyone.
Good morning.
On behalf of the Martin Luther King Jr. State Holiday Commission, I want to welcome you. Thank you for coming this morning on this frigid Monday morning to the state of West Virginia, Dr. Martin Luther King Holiday Ecumenical Service. I want to say a special thank you to all of our legislators, congressmen, and women who are here, public service workers. Thank you all for coming and being a part of this great service in the Mansion of Capitol. Thank you all so much. It's truly an honor to be able to be here together today as we celebrate the life and legacy of Dr. King, what he only began to do, and as we have the opportunity today to honor those who are also continuing the legacy of what he started to do, particularly to let freedom ring. The theme for our services here today are there's still work to be done. If not now, when? If not you, then who? All we have to do is look around at our society and realize there is still much work that needs to be done.
Amen.
But by God's grace, we will accomplish the task at hand. We're going to have a Reverend Joseph Jarrett, pastor here at Asbury United Methodist Church, begin the service with a prayer.
I know that the first thing that we do in welcoming folks is to tell you where the restrooms are. And there are still only two. We're working on the other. But they're right downstairs in the hallway beneath us. There are the two restrooms, men's restroom that you'll encounter first, and the ladies' restroom is just around the corner. So having taken care of the necessities and noticing that BJ has welcomed the dignitaries, I'd like to point out, I was just thinking to myself, now do I have to welcome the dignitaries, because I will not get all those names and all those official positions right. I think I'd rather welcome all the dignitaries in the room, and that's all of you. That's all of you. Because as we've learned, as we look around this room, and as we look at our situation and our culture today, all lives matter. All lives matter. We're especially focused on those that Dr. King began with his movement, but he was already expanding far beyond the limits of our limited memories, because our memories are often memories of convenience that allow us to think, well, wasn't it magnificent what was done? And then we can go back to being our ordinary selves. Today, we believe that the Spirit of Almighty God has brought us together. I do not call you to worship. God has called us all to worship. God has called us all to put our lives on the line, to be the water changed by the presence of God into the wine of celebration of life and the dignity of all. And that we are all God's children, whatever some may say. Let us be in prayer. Gracious and almighty God, compassionate and merciful one, you look upon us this day and you rejoice with us that we are willing to come together to remember and to celebrate and, most of all, to commit ourselves again to the work unfinished, to the lives yet meant to be saved, to be helped, to be healed, to be embraced, to be called your children, so that they can believe that we believe it. And we're willing to be your servants to make it clear, abundantly clear, that all lives matter. for the courageous words and courageous deeds that we know scared him. He knew the threats. He knew the oppression. He knew that any day, and the day would come too soon, that he might be called away from us, taken from us. But his dream was that we would finally get to the promised land, and we're not through. We're not there. We're so far. He knew he wouldn't get there with us, but he would meet us when we arrived. We pray that those of us who have our mountaintop experiences might do the work in the valley. In your name, in accordance with your will, in honor of your love for us all, amen.
Very quickly, something very important for the continuation of the service today that I forgot. If you would please check your cell phone to make sure that it is put in either back raise or off position. Not a plane ride, but it would be greatly appreciated. We will give you opportunity to take selfies when the service is over. Now we will have some meditations and prayers. We're going to have on behalf of the Islamic Association of West Virginia, Sue Barazzi, and from the Denal Pastoral Counseling Center, Reverend Dr. Sky Kircher will be speaking. We've contacted several rabbis from the area, and they were all out of town, but they all received their regards. I have not been able to get the service today. But we would please make welcome first Ms. Sue Barazzi and Reverend Dr. Scott Church.
Good morning.
Good
peace be upon you all. I am 50 Sam Superazi, and I'm representing the Islamic Association of West Virginia. Today, on this momentous day, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., we are gathered here to celebrate the change makers, the peace builders, and justice seekers in this great country of ours. Today, we are here to honor an extraordinary man in American history, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who changed the course of history in this country and actually all over the world. His influence for justice, for peace, equality, and freedom of all mankind is felt all over the world. As Dr. Martin Luther King said, justice anywhere is a threat. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. These are the same values Islam teaches us. That is the true Islam. Not the so-called Islam hijacked by criminals and thugs. Islam's respect for diversity originated in the Quran. While describing many of Allah's signs for mankind, the Quran states, and I will say it in Arabic first and then translate it. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wa min ayatihi khalqu as-samawati wal-ardi wa ikhtilafu al-ansanatikum wa alwanikum. Inna fi dhalika li ayatin And of his signs is the creation of the heavens and the earth, and the diversity of your tongues and your colors. Indeed, there are signs in this for the wise. That's chapter 30, verse 22. In these verses, God intended people to speak languages and exist as different cultures. The Quran elaborates further in another chapter, and again I will start with the Arabic verse. Bismillah ar-Rahman. Ya ayyuhan nas inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha wa ja'alnakum shu'uban wa qabaila lita'arafu. O mankind, we created you from male and female and made you into nations and tribes so that you may know one another and not deny one another. Indeed, God says that mankind is not only destined to exist as diverse people, but that we as humans should welcome this diversity and actively try to understand people who are different from ourselves. This message of pluralism within Islam bears a striking resemblance to Dr. King's vision and idea. God bestowed upon every human being the right to live their lives in the same way, regardless of the color of their skin or the language of their tongue. God wants us all to be good, equal, loving, just, and Dr. King taught us that we should all live by these simple rules for all of us to do God's will here on earth. We should all stand against racial or religious hatred, xenophobia, gender discrimination, and violence against any human being, no matter what ugly name it wears. Now it's our responsibility, all of us combined, to follow Dr. King's footsteps and to carry the torch for justice. This is a true message of Islam, and it is the true teaching of the great teacher of all times, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. What Dr. King saw in his vision encompassed all Americans, all human beings, regardless of their color, ethnicity, or religion. As the Reverend said, we have not reached the dream that Dr. King had for us in America. We have not. We are not there yet. We have a lot of work to do to achieve justice, peace, and for all mankind. Young African American Sikhs or Muslims, if they follow their tradition, should not be attacked or killed randomly on the streets. Should not be. And this is a heartbreaking issue. It will take all of us combined to stand in solidarity against violence and against discrimination and injustice. Dr. Martin Luther King said, "The time is always right to do what is right. The time is always right to do what is right."
Amen.
So we need to stand up and let the whole world hear our voices to do the right thing. Stand up to hateful rhetoric. Stand up to injustice. Stand against violence. Let us join hands in the fight against prejudice, bigotry, and end discrimination as we stop. We, the children of Abraham, shall continue to work together to make Dr. Link's legacy and the great civil rights movement he started lives on. Let us make this great country of ours is a beautiful place for peace, for you, for me, for everybody. For all of you, human beings, we are all God's children, Muslims, Christians, and Jews. And on behalf of the Islamic Association in West Virginia, I would like to express my sincere appreciation to for all the efforts the organizers for this program and for including us in this program, and may God bless you all.
Friends who have come to be uplifted. It's a wonderful day. The governor could not be here this morning, but will be with us later in the day for the rest of the activities, and he is sending this greeting to you. As governor, I welcome you to the 2016 Martin Luther King Jr. State Holiday Commission's special service in honor of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. I'm pleased to see citizens of the Mountain State pay tribute to Dr. King and his many contributions to this nation. His extraordinary vision and unwavering perseverance were instrumental in the civil rights movement, altering the face of American history forever. Dr. King made his mark on individuals and society as a whole, and his tireless efforts are an exceptional example for all of us. I applaud his diligent work for improved racial relations, kindness, and understanding. He was a remarkable man. His impact will never be forgotten. Again, welcome to today's celebration of Dr. King's life and his amazing influence. I'm sure it will be an uplifting experience for everyone. Totally honored, Governor. Thank you for inviting me to be a part of this incredible event. It is a pleasure to be with you today as we come together to honor the legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Thank you to Dr. Carolyn Stewart and her staff at the Herbert Henderson Office of Minority Affairs for taking the time to organize this event. You are such an asset to our governor and the state of West Virginia, and thank you for all you do. As United States citizens today, we are all most fortunate to live here in this time and place, where we have so many rights and privileges and all the tools we need to make our dreams a reality. We live in a world that is better, but in many ways more complex than the one in which we labored. Today reminds us that we must never forget those men and women who came before us and who have made our way of life possible. Because we are so blessed, we must take the time to remember Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and all that he stood for. Through his ideas, principles, and actions, this great man enabled us and inspired us to be who we are and where we are today, physically, mentally, spiritually, and professionally. He has now been dead longer than he lived. And yet today, we pause to reflect on that kind, strong, courageous, and persistent man who made such a tremendous difference in our country and its people. As Dr. King said in his book, Strength to Love, we are not makers of history, we are made of history. In order to look forward, to truly understand where we are, and to create the vision for where we are going, it is critical that we look back to where we have been and learn from the brave, outstanding individuals of the past, like Dr. Martin Luther King. We must continue to uphold those principles of which Dr. King so humbly believed. We must continue to speak up for ourselves and what we believe in. We must carry ourselves with confidence and do the best to create awareness, opportunities, and empowerment for our children, our grandchildren, and ourselves. We must continue to strive for equality and basic human rights and be kind and generous to each other. We must continue to be inspired and motivated to bridge the gap between saying and doing, so that we may be the change that we so desperately want to see in our state, our country, and our world. No one has expressed it better than Dr. King in a draft of his famous speech, I Have a Dream. We must never return to negative normalcy. We must march forward with spirit, with love, and dedication to a new, creative, positive normalcy. A normalcy in which we recognize the brotherhood of men on Monday as clearly as we acknowledge the fatherhood of God on Sunday. A normalcy in which we transform the jangling discords of injustice in our land into a harmonious and melodious symphony of fraternity. Tomorrow's history will reflect today's decisions. So let us go forth and live each day as Dr. King would have us live. We have come far, but we all know that we have challenges that remain. We will continue to strive for the day when we can see our differences, but not let them rule our behavior. Thank you for allowing me to share this morning with you, and God bless each of you. Thank you. To our presiding officer, Reverend Roberts, to our visiting minister and dignitary, Reverend Rivers, to all of the elected officials who are in attendance, and to you, the community at large, we welcome you to the ecumenical service. This is always a very special time, but today is a little difficult. The singing of the Appalachian Children's Chorus has me so filled up. We hear them every year, along with the Martin Luther King male chorus, but aren't they beautiful? Of the love that our commission has for the community at large. These awards are presented annually by the commission to honor West Virginians who best exemplify through their actions and their personal traits the principles and ideals characterized by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. in his pursuit of social change. Dr. King has had an influence on all of our lives, and that influence continues in the 21st century. The awards that are given by the commission are in six categories. The first award is in the area of peace. This year's recipient of the Advocate of Peace Award is a person who has been an advocate of change in a nonviolent way. The Reverend Gary Moore, during his tenure as pastor of the Scotts Creek Baptist Church in Bluefield, West Virginia, organized a series of memorial and remembrance activities to commemorate and memorialize the 5th and 6th U.S. Colored Cavalry who were executed by Confederate forces for the crime of wearing Union Army uniforms. Reverend Moore worked with the youth of his church and members of his community to conduct ceremonies involving lighting luminaries, placement of flags, and offering prayer in memory of the African American soldiers who fought and died during the battle. The services were not without controversy because there were organized protests which focused on the display of Union symbols on Confederate memorials. But Reverend Moore and the members of his church handled this in a nonviolent way. We are saluting him today for his tenacity in the organization of the memorial and remembrance services, which exemplified the dedication of this church and their focus on the symbol of healing, not just racial healing, but political reconciliation as well. Join us in saluting the Reverend Gary D. Moore, Sr., Bluefield, West Virginia. This year's recipient
is honored for the manner in which she has rendered service in the public and private sectors. Mrs. Sharon Smith Mice is a reflection of the word sharing of self. We work on campus together at West Virginia State University, and students are always uttering the name of Mrs. Mice when they need assistance. And she has helped them in many ways through purchasing books, through having their tuition paid, any way that she can give service. And one of the things that is most touching about Mrs. Bynes is the fact that although she's busy, she leads Bible study for our football team on Thursday nights. And that's something that she does because she loves her students. She loves her school, West Virginia State University. She loves her church, and she is an avid worker at St. Paul AME Church. She serves as the president of the West Virginia Conference, Women's Missionary Society, and at West Virginia State, she's director of New Student Programs. Her love for young people is evident when you watch her. She also focuses on her spirituality, and she is not ashamed to lift up the name of Jesus at any time. And she's also ready to give maternal advice when students need that quick, swift kick sometimes to get them in here. So she wears many roles, but while she's doing all of that, in addition to her love for West Virginia State, she also loves her alma mater, Tennessee State University, and she serves on the board there also. It is my pleasure to present this woman who shares herself on a daily basis with joy in her life, Mrs. Sharon Smith Jones. Presented to the Reverend Nelson B. whose life, in addition to his work for the uplifting of God's kingdom as a pastor, he also serves in civil rights capacities. He has worked as vice president of the Raleigh County branch of the NAACP. He has been a noted lecturer on issues of civil rights and the plight of African Americans and women in the history of America, and has served on panels with Attorney Generals Janet Reno and Eric Holder, and noted civil rights activist Harry Belafonte. He has a pragmatic approach to race relations in today's society, and he feels that in order for a real healing to occur in the United States, two important steps must be taken. First, he states, there is a minimizing effect of other people's suffering that must stop before we can move forward. I feel you have to admit that racism occurred and still does occur. And he also said, people who have been affected by discrimination must be careful not to discriminate against other people. You have to be careful not to do any more harm. And if we could live those words, think of the way that our world could become. Join me in congratulating our human and civil rights recipient, the Reverend Nelson B. Works of scholarly intellectual, and creative merit. She is the sales and marketing manager at West Virginia University Press and the acquisitions editor and manager of Vandalia Press, its creative entity. WVU Press publishes peer-reviewed books and journals in a set of four areas aligned with the strengths of West Virginia and the needs of the people of West Virginia, and is the only university press in the state. Join me in congratulating Abby Freeman for her contribution to scholarship. The Governor's Living the Dream Award is the epitome award, and it is presented to a West Virginian who best exemplifies all of the characteristics of justice, scholarship, sharing of self, human and civil rights, and advocacy of peace, with a recognizable sense of civic awareness and public service. When I first met Dr. Michelle Mickle-Foster years ago, and I listened to her mentor, Reverend Haliger, talking to me about the way he had stolen this chemist from carbide, you know, I was really amazed at the work that was done at Ferguson Baptist Church, which later culminated into the development of PISRA, the Benoit Institute for Social Research and Action. It's a faith-motivated nonprofit organization that was established by the church. And Dr. Foster used her creativity, her systems thinking, her problem-solving ability, her engineering skills, her love for people, to transform Kisper into one of the most impactful and enterprising community-based organizations in the state of West Virginia. It currently serves and empowers over 2,500 West Virginians. And her work has not gone without giving her some credit, because her leadership experience and her knowledge of obtaining grants has made her a sought-after speaker, both locally and nationally. She has presented on topics ranging from logic models to program evaluations, sustainability, best practices in fatherhood, social enterprises, family economic stability, and the list goes on and on, because of this tremendous love that she has for people, children, and the community. Her work has been recognized because she has received the Civil Day Wright Award from the state of West Virginia, the Fatherhood Champion of Change recognition for President Barack Obama, an award for community service from the Charleston Police Department, Minority Business Champion from the United States Small Business Administration, and West Virginia State University's President's Award for Community Service. Dr. Foster feels that she is living the American dream, and she has stated that there is no limit to what can be done when you work hard. She proudly states, no one should put limits on themselves. In the fulfillment of her dream, another theft has been performed. Dr. Foster was recently appointed as the president and CEO of the Greater Kanawha Valley Foundation. So, Father Haliger, we're going to have to search again. It is with great pleasure that I present the Governor's Living the Dream Award to Dr. Michelle Mickle-Foster.
Thank you. feeling humbled and honored to receive this. I'm thankful to God for placing me here, Mr. Chairman, and giving me the gift that he has. I'm thankful to my pastor, the guy who was up there, Reverend Keller, for stirring up those gifts at Curtis and Memorial Baptist Church. I'm thankful for my parents. They live in New York. They're not here, but I'm thankful for them, for they're the best mentors that Brooklyn has.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I thank the people of Israel. I know one of our senior managers is here. I'm receiving this honor on their behalf. The most dedicated team. As I go forth to the Greater Kanawha Valley Foundation, as Dr. King says, when I can't fly, I'll run. When I can't run, I'll walk.
Yeah.
And when I can't walk, I'll call. But I will be moving forward.
Yeah.
Thank you, Foundation. With this great opportunity. I know board chair is here, Melvin Jones. I'm thankful for him. Mr. Capito was telling me he was a former board chair. I'm just thankful to them for believing in me. And February 8th, I'm heading there. Thank you again.
Today, we are proud to honor two organizations. First, the West Virginia Center for African American Art and Culture in Charleston, West Virginia. The center is a nonprofit organization founded in 2000 by Anthony L. Kanzer, the executive director. The center's goals are to provide an enhanced cultural learning experience and to promote public recognition and understanding of the record of African Americans in local, state, and national history. The center is organized around the belief in cultural and ethnic diversity, the embodiment of a multicultural society. The purposes of the center are to collaborate with individuals and organizations across the state and others to offer information relative to social and other changes affecting the African American community. Would Mr. Anthony Kanzer please come forward and we congratulate you for the work you have done.
Every meeting, the last line says, expansive work of life. We in this room and all over this country exemplify that in everything we do. We, Western Virginia Center for African American Culture, giving thanks to Casey James, who was instrumental in talking to me and sitting me down and firmly telling me how to get things done in Charleston, in the black community, and enhancing what has already been done. I'm thankful for that, and I'm thankful to all the congratulations and thank you that I received for that and what we as organizations have done. I thank you for your recognition, and want to continue what the organization is striving to do, collaborate and become a service organization to our community. Thanks.
The mission statement of this 501c3 foundation is to provide financial aid and counseling to eligible individuals in the underserved African American community of the Clarksburg area who are pursuing vocational or educational goals. It was with pleasure when I read the application that I noted that one of the members of our community in Institute, West Virginia, served on the board of directors of the Kelly Miller Foundation, attorney James Williams. And what is so unique about the Kelly Miller Foundation is that most of the contributions come from donations from the alumni. Those contributions have totaled more than $250,000, with over $134,000 being awarded in scholarships. And there have been additional contributions made from organizations to support this initiative. What is so unique about the Kelly Miller Foundation is that the members of this foundation are all graduates of the former Kelly Miller High School in Clarksburg, West Virginia. They meet three times yearly, and they receive no financial compensation. They go to the meetings on their own. We are so proud today to salute this foundation, the Kelly Miller Foundation, and we would ask Attorney Williams to come forward, please, to receive the award on behalf of your foundation.
Thank you.
prophets, David talked about the goodness of the Lord. Now, David should not be the only one to talk about the goodness of the Lord. If you woke up this morning, clothed in your right mind, shoes for your feet, and clothes for your back, and food for your table, you ought to tell somebody about the goodness of the Lord. Do I have a witness? He's an awesome God. He's a mighty God. I'm a witness that he's an awesome God. I had cancer, and they told me that I would need 10 chemo treatments. I had 3, and they told me not to come back. And that was 17 years ago.
In the valley, in the arena of civil rights, particularly in South Carolina, his efforts helped to elect over 300 politicians into office. He is no stranger to hard work and commitment to his alma mater, Wilberforce University, where he is a skilled fundraiser and helped bring much-needed funds to Wilberforce. He is no stranger to hard work and to commitment in the efforts that were put forth to remove the Confederate flag from the state capital of South Carolina, which occurred in July. He is no stranger to hard work and to commitment as he helped to establish the Charleston Area Justice Ministry as a founding member, which is an interfaith, interreligious group of greater than 20 congregations in the Charleston, South Carolina area, committed to the work for justice to address the root causes of poverty and injustice through the empowerment of marginalized persons. Our guest speaker is no stranger to the hard work and commitment to his first ministry, which is to his family, to his wife, his four children, and his seven grandchildren. Luke chapter 10, verse 2 speaks that the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. I can share with you that our guest speaker understands the importance of labor and laboring in the valley. While the work in the valley continues, we will have a great opportunity to hear from our speaker to give us words of truth and conviction and passion surrounding the pressing issues of our time. There is still work to be done, and if not now, then when? And if not you, then who? Please join me in warmly welcoming our guest speaker, the Reverend Rivers Nelson III.
Thank you, Dr. Stewart. you for taking your time to still with me, so I didn't have to buy a jacket larger than I am, but God bless you for taking it. To Reverend Clergy, to our elected officials, to tremendous Appalachian Children's Chorus, I was not only moved, I already inspired with myself on how I would get you to the real Charleston so I can move. Give them a hand clap. Martin Luther King Jr. Male Chorus. I'm a big fan of male choruses. We have one at charity. They only let me sing with them once a year. And then when I sing solo. Solo, they cannot hear me sing. That is their thing. To the commission, let me thank you for accepting the recommendation or the challenge to have you to come for your annual celebration of the life and the work of one of my heroes of the movement, Dr. King. To each of the award recipients, I was impressed with the description of your work and thoroughly enjoyed all of your comments about how important the award is that you did receive. And let me join in with the commission to commend you and recommend that you share your award with family and friends so they will not misunderstand the depth of the work you do. To all those yet here assembled, I was really glad when my sister from the Islamic community came to speak and somebody said amen. I was in fear that there would be no amens here today, and that's going to be tough for a Baptist preacher. Nobody knows how to say it. I really found it a treat that the brother who's not Jewish came to represent the Jewish community. and represented anyway. So that means that you understand the need for ecumenical witness and interreligious service. So beloved, I greet you in the strong name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. My brothers and sisters who call on Allah, I bring you the greeting of peace, wa salam alaykum. To my brothers and sisters who call in Yahweh, great Jehovah, from the house of David, the root of Judah, that I would say to you, shalom. And to those who don't know who to call, I say to you, what's up? The power of the privilege I did not pay attention enough to Dr. Easton at the time to recognize that it was the MLK State Holiday Commission with the great state of West Virginia. And I am not afraid to admit that that added to the pressure, because when it belongs to the state, there are certain requirements that ought to be met. And one of them is brevity. And if you wanted brevity, you probably should not have invited me to come, but I'm going to do the best I can. I'm going to do the best I can to adjust how we do what we do. If you have a Bible or know a Bible or know what a Bible is, if you would open it, you have it in your phone, in your iPad, in your heart, or in your hands, and go to the book of Mark, the Gospel, the oldest Gospel, the second one in the chronological outlay of the Bible, Mark the 9th chapter. Beginning at verse 2, the word of God, and those who are from my tradition, if you stand and honor the word of God as I read to you, I would be grateful to God with you, Jesus. Mark 9, beginning at the verse number 2 down to verse 9, reads like this from the New Living Translation. 6 days later, Jesus took Peter, James, and John and led them up a high mountain to be alone. As the men watched, Jesus' appearance was transformed, and his clothes became dazzling white, far whiter than any earthly bleach could ever make them. Then Elijah and Moses appeared and began talking with Jesus. Peter exclaimed, "Rabbi, it's wonderful for us to be here. Let's make 3 shelters as memorials, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He said this because he didn't really know what else to say, for they were all terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed him, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my dearly loved son. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, Moses and Elijah were gone, and only Jesus was with them. As they went back down the mountain, he told them not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. May the Lord have a blessing to the reading, the hearing, and the doing of his words. You may be seated. Thank you. As I prepared this word, something happened. Tend to me. I have been searching for a sermon Dr. King did that does not appear in the Stanford papers, does not appear in the collection at King Center. But I knew it was Dr. King because of his voice, and I knew it must exist somewhere. As I prepared, someone, my tax preparer, matter of fact, I was anticipating that January was coming, I had to get ready. I sent him a note to let him not be late again this year as usual. And would you prepare? And he told me he was now doing taxes for the King Center. So well, can you search for me for Dr. King's sermon, Back to the Valley? And he said the reason I could not find it is that it does not find itself entitled Back to the Valley. Said the valley is calling. And said if you put it in quotations, you'll find it. And then I did, and it dawned on me as I prepared to come and start what I call now. This is the beginning of the season of blackness. And January 15th, last Friday, became what I call official kickoff for the season of blackness. For about 45 days, black people are going to be black. From January 15th to the end of February. And after Black History Month, there might be a lot of things, but Black will not be able to. Let's go for 45 days. Black is going to be in. Black is going to be stylish, and Black is going to be popular. Black people be asked to come speak at Black History programs. I'm speaking all over America, and all the work you can do during 65 days, you're going to cram it into 45 days, the season called blackness. Here I am in Charleston, West Virginia, the season of blackness. For the blackest man to be recognized still after his death, Dr. King. The reason I call it that is really only partly tongue-in-cheek, is that we have been forced out of habit and sometimes out of economy to try to celebrate a history that cannot be done in 45 days, cannot be done in 45 years, and the truth be told, cannot be done in 4,000 years. But because at the beginning it was, at the end it shall be, in between it is to be lived. But Dr. King helped me with this because on December of 1964, after he had received the Nobel Peace Prize and had agreed that he would give all the money away that he had been awarded for the prize, came back to New York and was then fed by the governor of Nelson Rockefeller, had dinner with the governor, was called to the UN, recognized everywhere, but he stopped by Harlem and went to the National Guard Armory in Harlem, and Dr. King stood, and I quote him now, and he said, "This has been a marvelous week in my life. I've been so moved by the experience that I had in Europe, meeting hundreds and thousands of people of goodwill. And so I tell you, my friends, for the last 10 days, I've been on a literal mountaintop, having transfiguring experiences. Oh, we've had the privilege of meeting and talking with kings and queens, meeting and talking with prime ministers of nations, meeting and talking with humble people of the land. I would love to stay here because it's a marvelous mountain. And I can tell you that it does mean a little something because I do live almost every day under the threat of death. And it's a fit contrast to have people saying nice things about you. It would be nice if I could stay up here. I wish I could stay on this mountaintop. But isn't it the usual pattern of my life to have people say nice things about me? Oh, this is a marvelous mountaintop. I wish I could stay here tonight, but the valley calls." Dr. King was simply making the point that there are times in life, and for my community it happens almost every Sunday, we go to the mountaintop. And we experience the transfiguration of becoming something that we're not. To something marvelous, but it doesn't last very long. And then we leave the mountain and nothing changes. We come back next Sunday or next Saturday to the mountaintop. Dr. King was lifting up for me what I think is critical to understand about him, that many of us have these annual celebrations. And our oratory is magnificent. Our witness is tremendous. We say wonderful things about each other. We come together in the most integrated time, the most diverse crowds we find outside of funerals are here. But it'll be another year before this many whites and blacks, Jews and Muslims come together in the same place. And isn't it something that Dr. King, a little Baptist preacher from down in Georgia, is able to do this? But while we come up to be transfigured to that which we have not been, we need to recognize that the work is not on the mountain. The work is in the back. How much do you know? I say this about him with all sincerity, as was recorded by the reporter who did such a good job in capturing my comments in an interview with him in your paper, that Dr. King, as I agree with my friend, Dr. Freddie Hayes, has become the victim of identity theft. They have changed him from what he was to what is more acceptable, more palatable, more digestible than what he was. Dr. King is not the kind, nice Negro that made everybody happy. They don't kill kind, nice Negroes that make everybody happy. He was not the one who always brought peace or always brought resolution. They didn't lock him up 30 times because he was a happy, go-along, get-along fellow. They did not try to kill him over and over again because he was such a sweet guy. No, Dr. King was a radical replica of Jesus the Christ. That Dr. King was one who challenged what was because it was wrong. And because those who want to do wrong and keep the status quo will always try to strike down that which challenges what is wrong. So who do you know him to be? He was born at high noon, the 15th day of January, 1929, in his house on Auburn Avenue, known as Sweet Auburn. He was born as Michael King because his daddy was named Michael King. His father, when Dr. King was about 5 years old in 1934, went to Germany and encountered the work of Martin Luther, the great Protestant reformer. And so Martin Luther's work so challenged King Sr. that he changed his own name to Martin Luther King Sr. and at the same time changed the name of his son from Michael King to Martin Luther King Jr. Why is that important? Because you need to recognize, especially young folk, doesn't matter what your name is, what you do will make your name mean something. And so when Dr. King understood this over the years, you understand that he graduated from Booker T. Washington High School when he was 15 years old. He skipped the 9th grade, skipped the 12th grade, and graduated, then went to Morehouse. And as brilliant as he was, when he got to Morehouse, he almost flunked out because the poor education he got in Atlanta, Georgia, did not have him reading but at an 8th grade level. And so when he started school at Morehouse, he realized that you can be the big fish in a small pond. But when you get to the big pond, everybody's just a fish. And so when he recognized that there were students there from all over the world at Morehouse, an international institution, brilliant, the best of every class. They weren't just the last in the class, they were the best in the class. And so Dr. King was so frustrated by his failings, he thought started with his school. But a man from my home state of South Carolina, Dr. Benjamin Elijah Mays from Epworth, South Carolina, stood in the way. And God has a way of putting people in your path who will change the direction of your life, even without this cooperation. Martin King went on to graduate from Morehouse, and then went to Crozer Seminary, where he received his degree in divinity, then went to Boston University to receive his PhD in systematic theology. And don't you know, while he was defending his dissertation, he was called to preach at Dexter Avenue Baptist Church, which really messed up his plans, because Dr. King had no intention of preaching. I can't imagine any child of a pastor ever wanting to be a pastor. I cannot imagine that you watch your dad or your mama go for that and to save your life's work, I want to do that. That would not be on the list of things to do. You're dealing with crazy folk, bringing the crazy problems to you. You talk about you like a dog, but not the same. You talk about you like a dog, but not the same. Mess up your own lives, get messed up and all kinds of stuff. I want you to snap your finger and say, Lord, peace, be still. So Dr. King had made up his mind he was not going to preach, for sure. And certainly was not pastor, he was going to be a professor. He was recruited because of his brilliance to be a corporate leader. And he went down to Montgomery, really, to follow the path of getting back home to Ebenezer, to be in the pulpit with his daddy as associate pastor, and rock his world from there. This was not on his agenda, but God had a different agenda. And so when Dr. King got down to Alabama, he met a man named E.D. Nixon by the telephone. And don't you understand, Rosa Parks had been locked up on the first day of December 1955. And Rosa Parks was not the first black woman to be kicked off the bus for not obeying the segregated racist law. She was the fourth black woman. The other three did not quite meet the standard. They were either teenagers who had children out of wedlock, or they were not rich enough, or they were not middle class enough. And so when the right black person gets locked up, then all the other black folk pay attention. But if you're not the right black person, they might not pay attention. That's just not that's what it is. So the right black person got locked up. And so A.D. Nixon called Dr. King on the phone and said, Dr. King, we are tired of the way they treat us in Montgomery. You're a new pastor in town. You're a young man, about 26 years old. Why don't you come to the meeting we're having tonight with the preacher so we can deal with this hot, the segregation of the buses in Montgomery? Dr. King said, I just got here. I'm not sure whether I want to get involved. After all, he was a product of a middle class upbringing, and he did not know whether he could sully his hand as soon as he got to town to get involved in some local politics. And so E.D. Nixon continued to call other preachers. And finally he called Ralph Abernathy. He called them and he finally got back to King about 30 preachers down. And said, Dr. King, have you thought about my invitation? He said, yes, I've done some checking and I think I will come. He said, well, it's a good thing because the meeting was going to be at your church. Reverend Nelson was a Pullman car porter. He was a man of brilliant intellect, powerful and courageous, but he also was a lonely figure because preachers who stand against the power in the community will often find themselves ostracized, threatened, and even folk will run away from him. I'm always amazed at the mythology that's been backed up in Dr. King and in the black church, the myth that the black church is always down for the protest program. That's not true. Not many black churches were involved with Dr. King. Not many black churches are involved now. That's why I don't get upset when preachers don't show up, don't work out, and don't want to be there with the program, because if they did, it would be a radical change in what they do.
Right.
What they do is not do this.
That's right. That's right.
That's right. I make a point to mention who he was, because when Dr. King was first introduced to this, he came as a reluctant participant. Then the meeting at his church, and then Ralph Abernathy were walking and talking, wondering who would be the leader of the movement. They decided that Ralph would be the leader. But in the meeting, E.D. Nixon got up and said to the crowd of black clergy there at the church, "The problem in Montgomery is we got too many boys in the pulpit." He said, "We got black men who call themselves pastors, but they're scared. And it's because we got so many scary men, that's why we're having so much trouble in Montgomery." Dr. King stood up and said, "I'm not a boy, I'm a man." And he said, "Good, you're the president." Be careful when your emotion makes you insert your foot into your mouth. So what is Montgomery? That Dr. King was a great orator. He was a theologian. He was a tremendous writer. But when you examine him closely, you will find that his theology, his methodology, his philosophy were not shaped alone by Thoreau or Gandhi or even the great principles of ethical text. His life work was shaped by the solitary life of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
He understood Jesus to be a rattler, a troublemaker, a thorn in the side of the establishment. He understood that Jesus was the one who touched the women and the men considered them untouchable.
Yes.
He understood that Jesus opened the temple and let those who were out because they didn't have health insurance.
Yes.
Let them into the temple. It was Jesus who spoke to the wine odor, the lowlifes, the scoundrels of the earth. It was Jesus who cried against the religious hypocrites who were holy in their talk, but wicked in their walk. And so Jesus became the model for Dr. King. So here we are on the mountain of MLK Day. And all over America, people who hated Dr. King, hate what he stood for, hate what his legacy is, will stand with those who love him and cry out good things about him, singing Hosanna to y'all off key, and singing Come by y'all, and asking other folk, just hold a hand, let's all get along.
Yeah.
But the truth of the matter is, Dr. King has made it this far, not because of how much you love him, but because of how much he loved what he was doing. And so he was a prophet. And he recognized that prophecy now has a single definition. There was a time in the Old Testament when a prophet was defined by two things. Does what the prophets say ever come true? That means that you foretold. The other test of prophecy is, do you speak truth to power? That means you foretell. And so since Jesus has come, there's nothing left to be said. All the prophecies of the future have been reconciled. So that means the only thing left for prophets to do now is to foretell. And if you want foretelling, you're nothing but an entertainer who's getting paid once a week. The truth of the matter is that you must speak truth to power.
Right.
You must understand what the word of God said. He says in Micah, the book of Micah. Micah was when God himself called Israel together and said, "I have aught against you. I'm going to read my bill of particulars. I have become sick of you. I've saved you. I brought you out of the wilderness. I freed you from bondage. And I told you, treat each other with love. And let the rich among you rip off the poor. Yet the strong among you abuse the weak. I'm sick of you, Israel. I'm going to read my indictment against you." He said to Micah, "Read the indictment."
Yeah.
And Micah starts in chapter 1 and lays out God's case against Israel.
Yeah.
And then he gets to the 6th chapter. And he said, "But Israel, there's a way out of this." Mm-hmm. Israel said, "What is the way?" So I'm glad you asked. He said, in the 8th verse of the 6th chapter of Micah, he says, "He has showed you, O man, what is good. What does the Lord require of you but to do justice, love kindness, to do what he did, go where he went, and then celebrate living this dream. Yesterday at the Charity Missionary Baptist Church, I preached my sermon annually for our young people on the third Sunday because it's always Youth Sunday. And I pointed out to them to live in the dream. I watched the dream being lived yesterday on TV. Living the dream. A couple of weeks ago, I watched the dream being played out in the national championship. Clemson in Alabama. If you listen to Dr. King's I Have a Dream speech, which is really not the name of the speech, I'm glad you made that point. Dr. King was a great Baptist preacher. And preachers know that you don't ride a new horse in a momentous occasion. You don't try to figure out, will this work in a brand new thing? Because if it doesn't work, you're in trouble. And so Dr. King had to turn to something familiar for I Have a Dream. And he was making the point that down in Alabama, the fear of the racist, the governor, whose lips, he said, were dripping with interposition and nullification, was that black boys and black girls would go to school together. But then fast forward, what would have frightened them in Alabama in 1963? They celebrated in 2016. Because if the black boys weren't playing, Alabama would not have beaten Clemson. Because Clemson had black boys playing. My cousin integrated Clemson in 1963. And don't you know they said at that time black boys couldn't play quarterback. But if you find a school now that says black boys can't play quarterback, we'll be beating them in the championship year after year after year. So they live in the dream. They're getting paid to play a game that makes them millions of dollars. But they're just a byproduct of the movement. That was not the reason.
That's right.
It was those who went to school who never played football that this was all about. The church is challenged by this. And I'm so challenged by the church. As a pastor now, just going on 7.5 years, I often understand more clearly why Dr. King said this quote about the church. I quote him now. So often I've been disappointed because we've not received the cooperation of the church. So often the church in our struggle has been a taillight instead of a headlight. Mm-hmm. From his autobiography, he said this. There's work in the valley. As you conclude this day, don't leave the way you came. Let this be the day that you say on Mount Transfiguration what Jesus said to Peter, James, and John. There's work, Peter, in the valley. It's easy to let the high moment excite you and make you want to stay up here. But you cannot stay here. You must go back to the valley. So Jesus said to Peter, Peter, the valley is calling us. And you know when he got back, there was trouble in the valley.
Yes, there was.
There was sickness. A father brought his son to Jesus. And the challenge to us, how many men now bring their children to Jesus? Got down and the disciples were showing themselves to be faithless. They'd been with him. They knew what to say. They knew how to pray. But they didn't know how to serve him with the whole heart. So when he came down, he had to show them why they were not successful. Because they were sold out. We need, when we leave the mountain of transfiguration, to be sold out. Conclude by challenging you.
Amen.
I heard Pastor Joe talk about all eyes matter, and that's true. But let me help explain. One of my young mentees in Charleston is Muhammad Daba, and he's the local leader of Black Lives Matter. He finds himself often challenged and ostracized, and people try to mischaracterize why he does what he does. But let me explain it to you. We stipulate, I think there's some lawyers here, we stipulate that all lives matter. That's not the argument. The reason it says Black Lives Matter is because the only lives in America where it appears that it might not matter are the black lives. There's no one debating whether all lives matter. All lives matter is clear. That's why Dylan Roof, after he murdered my friend and 8 more people, could show up. Video known all over the world, could show up in North Carolina, get arrested with the gun in his possession, alive, and then get taken to Burger King to be fed before he's brought back to trial. And yet, Tamir Rice, when he stands in line with a gun, that's a pellet gun in a place you can carry a gun in public, is shot dead in 1.2 seconds, and because good lives did not matter. That's why because there's debate about whether all lives matter. We know all lives matter. We know that. But when they put those lives at the bottom of the ship and brought them there, and nothing was possible, those lives did not matter. In my state, in South Carolina, in 1834, they made it illegal to teach black folk to read. Because there was a school started by the man who started my college called Daniel Alexander Payne that taught black boys to read. And because the black boys went out to the plantation and called the snakes by their scientific name, the owner of the plantation, whose son was in the legislature, got threatened and told them to pass a law that teaches that no black person can be led to read in South Carolina. That was 1835. Don't tell me all the lives matter, because the black ones did not.
That's right.
Dr. King's movement was about making sure black lives matter.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Because the poor little girl who were killed in Birmingham, and the two boys who were killed later that day, the men who killed them were well known.
Well,
and not one church, not one white church, held a prayer vigil or said a word about the Klan members who lived and worshiped with them. Because the black it's one thing to have a narrative that makes you feel better, but it should not be the narrative that makes a lie out of the reality. So yes, Black Lives Matter make you upset. It's supposed to. The gospel challenges you because it's supposed to. Any preacher worth preaching is supposed to make you feel some discomfort. If all it does is placate and make you feel better, that's not preaching, that's entertainment. And you can get that on television.
Put it out. but I never ride in front of the bus, but I do. But I never go into the water, but I do. But I never be successful, but I do. And can we never be present, but we are. My mom was 92 now. Said, Mama, about 87, 88, no, 86. I said, Brother Obama, we have met, this is my third time meeting this brother. Brother, I believe you got in. At that time, he was behind the parents, had not gone South Carolina, had not gone Iowa. He was behind Hillary Clinton. I said, I believe you got in. He said, why do you think that? My mama told the people who were going to vote for her, with you, for you, in organizing caucus, that if you're not for Obama, get out. I said, Mama can't even pronounce your name. And when you got Mama, you got everybody. Because Mama understands what you are pierced through the veil of the lie about the world. So fast forward, I said to him, I don't know what you have that keeps you so calm in the face of so much turmoil. Right. What is it that allows me to move beyond the limits they set for you to exceed all of the expectations? Thank you for my $1.49 gas. I thank you for that. We got electric gas going to be $3.57. I got it. Filled up the other day for $19.80. Boom. But what I thought about it, I had Dr. Wright come to my church a few years ago. Dr. Wright was trying to explain to me, when he went down to Havana, Cuba, I was trying to explain the impact of Dr. King to people really did not live in America at the time. And we know his birthday was January 15th, but he was murdered on April 4th. 1968, I was 17 years old. I was a senior at my high school. I couldn't even honor his life because the superintendent wouldn't let us have a ceremony for fear of what we might do. And so I thought about how it felt on April 4th, 1968. Dr. Wright told the people in Havana, Cuba, it felt like it was all over. Our dreams died on the balcony in Memphis. And it seemed like it's all over now. The shining star has been taken down. And he was trying to explain, he said, he went back to old clothes he used to use about the man named Goethe, who came up with this theory of a man named Faust who sold his soul to the devil. And Faust's whole episode with the devil was then summarized in the painting. Some in one of the galleries of Europe. And the painting is called Checkmate. And in the painting, there is Faust, sweating bullets, looking at the board. And there is the devil smiling at him because the devil said, Checkmate. Game over. There's no more moves to be made. So while they walked through the gallery, the man explained what they were looking at. The crowd finally moved further down, and moved further down, and moved on. But one man never moved. They couldn't understand why. He never moved. He kept looking at the painting intently. Finally put his hands under his chin, rubbed his chin, and yelled through the top of his lungs, it's a lie! It's a lie! The king has another move. The crowd spun around and looked at him and said, surely you jest. There's no way. We've looked at the board. We know how to play chess. There are no more moves. The king is checkmate. He said, ah, you looked at it through your layman's eye. But I am the Russian grandmaster of chess. And I can see on that board, there is another move. And he made the point that in April 1968, when Dr. King was murdered, the devil said, checkmate. And black folk all over America and all over the world hung their head down. But oh, on November 2008, 40 years later, my God has a way of moving in 40 years. In the wilderness of the end in 40 days.
Yeah.
40 days and 40 nights.
Yeah.
But those 40 years later,
yeah.
I was watching on television there at the NAACP headquarters, Sister Ridgeway. I was watching to see when CNN was going to project what the next stint would be.
Yeah.
I was waiting on California. I said to my wife on the phone, baby, hold on, because California comes in, it's going to be something big. I didn't know it was going to be that big. And then I talked to my baby girl down in D.C. at the bar, and she had the nerve. tell me, there you're at the bar watching the election return. I don't know if I want to know you at the bar watching the election return. Talking to my middle child down in Columbia, and she was talking about daddy. Do you think he might win? I can't let myself believe he's going to win. I just want to see what's going to happen next. And finally, I hung up on the phone. I told him, I got to come back. Wait a minute. CNN's about to put something up. And then, unbelievable to me, at the top of the screen, it said something I thought I would never live to see. That Barack H. Obama elected the 44th president of the United States. And that's
Thank you.
program. We want to read the prayer in unison together.
Black women. strike.
Yeah.
And the way they sustain themselves on strike was to go back to the wells of their tradition. They're saying a hymn by Timothy that says, I will overcome someday. But they changed the words and said, we shall overcome.
Yes.
And mostly they were migrant workers from John's Island, Watermelon, James Island.
Yes, sir.
And in the midst of that, they had a person working with them named Septima Clark. She was a great organizer. Septima went to the school up in Tennessee, the Highlander Folk School. And there she started singing the song. Miles Horton and Pete Sager and Dr. King heard her. And when they would go to the mass meeting, Dr. King said in the backseat with Septima, who he called Seppi. He said, Seppi, when we get there, will you sing that song? And Seppi started singing the song. Pete Sager then added melody to it. The movement in Albany started singing with more punch. And then the song went around the world. But you ought to know, young people, that when the children in China stared down the tank at Tiananmen Square, they were singing, we shall overcome. When the Great Wall of Berlin finally came down, they were singing, we shall overcome. And the song is not given to us in America alone. Everywhere where people yearn to be free,
yes, sir,
and are willing to accept the cost of freedom, which is often life and sacrifice, you need to be reminded, we shall overcome. And so I commend you, and also commend this beautiful choir, especially these young people. And this is my congregation, I want you to do better than us. That when you have come to the Mount of Transfiguration, when you go back to your schools and your valley, that you would have the courage from the words of King, that you would do work in that valley. That people will be different because you're different. And they will change because you have been changed. If everything stays the same, and all we had was single, tingling breaths that signified nothing. My prayer is that you take the change with you. And where you're going, they will be changed. Let's look to the Lord now. Father God, we thank you for being up here. The Lord, you told us we cannot stay on the mountain. It's cold up here. It's lonely up here. So people are in the valley. So Lord, in your word, you said in the book of Numbers to your servant Moses to tell his brother Aaron and go tell his sons, the priests, that I will make my face shine upon them and give them my peace. But in the next to the last book in our Bible, the brother of the Lord Jesus then put pen to paper and gave what most consider the universal benediction. And it starts with that awesome word, now. Lord, we've come for the moment of now. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling.
Yes,
the very one who will present you faultless before the presence of his throne with exceeding joy. To our only wise God, our Savior, be majesty, dominion, power, henceforth, now and forever. And every child of the Most High God say, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Hug somebody, tell me, love of God is good.